بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله أوله بلا أول كان قبله وآخره بلا آخر يكون بعده الذي قصرت عن رؤيته أبصار الناظرين وأجزت أن أتيه أوهام الواصفين ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا حبيبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين بالقاسم محمد وعليه الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين سيما بقية الله العظم إن كنتم مؤمنين ولعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكر فضائلهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله تعالى في محكمه كتابه المجيد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والذي أنزل سكينة في قلوب المؤمنين ليزدادوا إيمانا مع إيمانهم صدق الله العلي العظيم عظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Tonight's discussion is also in the honor or in the remembrance of those infallible souls without being reaching the age of bulugh have sacrificed their lives for Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. It seemed to be the center part of the first 10 nights these discussions come about, which really forces us, encourages us to contemplate, to think that the issue of youth, the issue of children is very important. We will be talking about the Shahadat of Abdullah ibn Hassan, who was the son of Imam Hassan alayhi salam, also known to be the last Shaheed in the plain of Karbala, by which the title of Abu Abdullah comes from that very Shahadat as well, because he was the last Shaheed. As we said that the message of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, which is for all humanity, especially when we look at the sacrifices of the children, it really asks us to take a genuine and strong step towards coming to aid, particularly in the contemporary era. I mean, the amount of zulm and oppression that is taking place upon the children today, it wasn't seen before. It seems that the children have no value at all, unfortunately. Whether that be in the most developed countries, whether that be in the third world countries. The same way as we promote blood donation through the teachings of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, through the rituals that is there in place for Imam Hussain alayhi salam, we say that you donate blood for Imam Hussain, such a beautiful act, a humanitarian act. So in the same fashion, we have to come together and really take that step to take care of the children of the world. As I was speaking to Dr. Razavi, one of the attendees of this very place, he mentioned me one thing. I will mention this with his permission, that while he was training himself to be a doctor, some pharmacist or some scientist came and gave a talk on the invention or a product of a pill, of a tablet which happen to cost 10 cents. And if this tablet, this pill is given to the children, they will be safe from many sort of illnesses. And they will be healthy. And the cost was just 10 cents. But because the pharmaceutical mafia, they did not allow that to be, you know, be in the sort of at the service of the people. So this is what the society we live in, and we regard this to be the most advanced and most modern society, where just for the sake of capital, they are willing to destroy insaniyat, willing to destroy humanity. So therefore, when we look our children and the environment that they've been given today, it is quite scary. You know, apart from their spiritual development, moral sort of development, even their physical defects that they might face, and all these gadgets that is we have today, do you have any idea that what sort of effect it will have to our children when they are 17, 18? They are like 24/7 almost on this iPods and video games. And what sort of effect that it will have? See, the world today is the world in the sense of dunya, the dunya manfi, that negative, is overwhelmingly after cutting the roots of insaniyat, of humanity, of human beings. Simple example of 10 cent pill, right? No matter how educated they are, no matter how powerful they are in their leadership, no matter how big the state is, the essential reality of their purpose and their mission, maybe they are unconscious about even their actions, they don't even know perhaps, you know, if we have Husn-e-Zan, is really cutting their own root. It's really cutting their own feet. And this is what shaitan is. Shaitan is adu mubin. Shaitan is an apparent enemy of insan. And he does waswas, and he takes different forms in order to destroy mankind, that there be no nasal, no race remains. So, apart from being, apart from worrying their spiritual abilities, we also have to think about their physical abilities, their physical sort of negative effect that it will place or it will have in their future. The food, the intake of food, their practices, their habits, and how they are detrimental for them and their future. I was trying to renew my passport in the American embassy just before I came, and you have these Orthodox Jews, you know, those who wear those black coats and, you know, very strict in their traditions, and it's very difficult to really break that ice. You know, they are like, you know, as soon as they sit, they will open a small Torah, you know, in Hebrew, and they will read. They will not really engage in any sort of dialogue with others. Perhaps this is my perception, you know, I may be wrong, but it seems that way for me. Then I saw there was another person who comes. He was from Germany. This person was from Poland. Obviously, they were American citizens. They came to renew or for report of birth. But they started communicating with each other in Hebrew. He speaks German, he speaks Polish, but Hebrew they were speaking so obviously fluently, and they understood each other. But look at the Ummat of Muslima. The Quran is revealed in Arabic. We have the Persians, we have the Indians, we have the, you know, Afghanis or, you know, other languages. They cannot communicate with each other in that language which the Quran was revealed. We are not paying attention to really train our children. If all the children of Muslim, they speak Arabic, for example, I mean the language of the Quran, it will be so powerful. But we don't really pay attention to, forget, leave aside, you know, Arabic. We are not even paying attention to our own language, for example, at home. If I know Urdu, and I should really teach my children Urdu or Farsi, for example, because that gives a complete different perspective in regards to the world, in regards to the dunya. Not only that I just teach them, but I maintain that contact with my roots. I take them to India and Pakistan and I show them, see how people are suffering and how you are here, where you should really, you know, appreciate of what's been given to you. One of the problems that our children have is that there's lack of appreciation. They take things for granted. How that come about? Because of the environment that they are living in, and it's required that we kind of train them that they appreciate every little thing. So they were speaking to each other, then finally I kind of like said hello and started speaking to him, and I asked him, because he had small children as well, do you have trouble raising kids here? Because if you look at them, their children, they are all speaking in Hebrew, they are all very dressed in traditional clothes, you know, and on the other hand, they are very happy as well. You know, the kids, they are enjoying, they are having fun, and they are like 5-6 of them all together, right? And you don't see them with gadgets, like how our kids are, you know. And the type of clothes they wear is not like the type of clothes we buy for our kids with brands and with, you know, soccer players and red and yellow. They are very dull. They wear dull colors. Gray, white shirt, maybe black shirt. Very simple. Now, I asked him, do you face issues, problems? He said, yes, very difficult. Living in England, they were, obviously, and it's not easy. I said, how about these cartoons and this television that... He said, we don't have TV, we don't keep televisions in our house. So, I mean, as a community, they have taken that step, and they know that all that has been fed to them, perhaps not 100%, maybe 80%, right, is garbage, and it's gonna really be detrimental for the tarbiyat of their children. So they don't, right? So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, we really have to be very careful from both sides. We can't be in promoting or practicing rohbaniyat, which means ascetism, you know, to that extent that we really deprive ourselves and our children. And at the same time, we have to have the dunya, we have to balance that as well. Sometimes we become too aggressive in upbringing our children, depriving them completely of the Western sort of environment and the problems and the issues that they face. I'm not going to take my kids to the movies, to the cinemas, for example. They're not going to go, you know. After they are teenagers, they will reach that, they will go by themselves. You are no longer there. It's rather better that I go with my child to a movie and I introduce him to this environment and I watch him, how he behaves in that environment. Then I just say, no, I'm not going there. And finally, when he's exposed to this, he doesn't know how to behave. So therefore, it's very difficult and it's not easy. Protecting our own iman, and then you have these responsibilities that we have. Right? So therefore, paying attention to our children, to children at large at the same time, from the educational side, from the tarbiyat side, from that physical, sort of from the point of view of the life as well, it's quite important. I mean, isn't it, don't you think that we have scientists, don't you think that we have, you know, chemists, that they could have their own industry where they could invent pills, medicine, tablets? We do have. I know, for example, 3 doctors here. I know 5 doctors wherever I go in, you know, in a place where I majlis, for example. Networking. You know, we could really make it happen and make these things that are basic needs of kids and children, particularly in terms of their physical well-being, in terms of their well-being, possible. And these majalises should be that source. And these majalises will bring that sincerity in us, because our maqsad and our purpose is the message of Aun and Muhammad, is the message of Ali Asghar alayhi salam. That's what we are doing it for. And this actions of ours will obviously have its own, you know, ta'asir, its own effect. We don't really have to announce that we are the followers of Hussein. Our actions will reflect that. The same way how the actions of Aun and Muhammad reflected that they are the son of Haydar and Ja'far al-Tayyar. The actions of Abul Fazl Abbas, where he did not even introduce himself in Battle of Siffin, reflected that it is really Ali, but he said it is the share of Ali, it is the lion of Ali, it is the son of Ali. So our actions will reflect that, that we are the followers of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Now we will embark in our discussion, just about 5-10 minutes, to really emphasize the issue of and the importance of children in our community, in our families. It's quite important to really attend to their needs, you know, and it's really a call, and we have to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we don't really know how and what way we will answer, you know, in terms of when بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ, you know, for what reason they've been killed. The Arabs were burning alive, and it hasn't changed. It's just the form of it is changed now. The way we are burying our children alive is providing them with and feeding them with and killing their iman, killing their Islam, killing their humanity. We ourselves, by providing that, we are doing that. You know, when we find, you know, Muslim parents being proud that, you know, their daughters go out and drink and dance and do nightclubs, what is that? That is really killing their own children, whether that be a daughter, whether that be a son, right? Killing that iman, ending up, you know, losing that faith, which becomes, that insan becomes valueless, because if he doesn't have insaniyat, what he has to give to the environment, to the society? So therefore, for what reason they've been killed, we've been asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. There are different levels of iman, as we were talking about the levels of iman, and we said that when Allah created iman, Iman asked for helpers. Allah provided 2 helpers. That was akhlaq and sakhawat, generosity. And the same way with kufr, He provided with misery and bad behavior. That akhlaq, that the way I behave, you know, that is the helper to my iman. If I behave in the best fashion, obviously we will look at certain practical aspect of it, because it is really iman that will come to our aid, that will really make us sort of in a state of tranquility whenever we have issues and problems. It is that iman. You know, on the plane of Ashura, the ashab and the family members and the little ones were in the perfect state of their iman. Nothing really made them sort of like upset and disappointed and worrisome of the calamities that they were befallen upon them. They never said that, oh, you know, we wish we wouldn't have been here. But rather the opposite. They were thankful. And Nothing really made them move from the iman that they had in Imam Hussain alayhi salam, in that deen, in that they might not be on the level of, you know, being a scholar how Habib ibn Mazahir was, other individuals, other people, but as their akhlaq, as they had that piety in them, that really helped them make that iman strong. And when the iman was strong, it reflected in their actions. It reflected, it's like saved them from being disappointed, saved them from losing that, you know, that belief, that deen, that Islam. Because, you know, when the musibat falls, as we say, وَقَالُوا إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, right? And it is not just Islam, meaning that zaharan, outwardly he says إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, but qalban, we really have to believe it is really إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. So what? If it happens, so what? You know, as we come from Allah and we will return back to Allah. Whether that be on and Muhammad being sacrificed, whether that be, you know, Ali Asghar being sacrificed. It's inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raja'un. Why is it that Imam Hussain alayhi salam was continuously, you know, reciting this kalima, this verse, inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raja'un? Why is it Imam Hussain alayhi salam was reciting the zikr of wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah over and over again? You know, why has that has been prescribed? And why his recitation of this zikr is for himself as well, but at the same time, when he recites, that brings tranquility and peace to the heart of Zainab. He would go fight, he would return back to the tents, he would say, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. That gives that peace and tranquility. That iman is secured there. You know, his pronouncing of La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, the imam. The imam saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raja'un. You know, that brings that peace and tranquility. And we feel this, you know, the imani aspect is usually something that we have to taste, something that we have to feel. It's as it is from the heart. If, so, I gave this example earlier as well, if there be loss of life, for example, if someone who is of high caliber, someone of a high ranking personality in terms of his ruh, you know, like a muttaqi person, like a, you know, marja or someone, he says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raja'un, you know, in his letter, in his speech, then that gives a sukoon, you know, to one's heart. Because that is coming from a person who believes in that, and he's saying that to us. So he is transferring that belief to my heart, and that is making me calm. Other things, like for example, there's marriage, nikah itself, the pronouncement of that nikah. Before their marriage, they were speaking to each other, they were with each other, for example, just to reach that sort of goal and purpose of getting married, to know each other. But after that nikah is recited, something changes. It's a completely different plane altogether. The taluqat, the relationship, how it becomes very strong, sort of a support of each other. You know, inshallah, we'll look at the aspect of the marriage and how iman plays a role in a successful marriage. You know, we will look at that as well. So what I'm trying to say is that it is that it's a question of that iman, and it is the question of that qalb and of the heart. When that takes place, things changes altogether. You know, a person who was completely foreign, a person who was na mahram, you know, I did not know her before, but after that pronouncing of the kalima, of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person becomes the most important individual of one's life, in terms of providing nafaqah, in terms of taking care of, in terms of, you know, the future, so on and so forth. So it is a thing that has to be felt by the heart. Now, there are darajat, as we said. The first and foremost is that Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu aminu, as the Quran clearly says, oh, you have brought iman, bring iman. So very zahiri. See, Islam, as we said, is the body, and the heart of this body is iman. So every level of iman is considered as Islam. The zahiri level, where one brings that you know, Islam, that is also an outward, there is some sort of iman there, whether that be even on his lips, you know, it is some sort of, you know, he's believing and he's saying something, you know, it hasn't really entered the heart, but it is there. Then, as Sixth Imam have said, that iman have 10 levels, and every level, you know, differs from each other. Like, for example, Miqdad is on the 8th level, you know, Abu Zar is on the 9th level, Hazrat Salman is on the 10th level. So these are the different levels of iman. So the same way, zahiran, a person says that, then there's an iman which is where a person accepts with the heart. For example, the Quran talks about the Queen of Sheba and Hazrat Sulaiman. When Hazrat Sulaiman brings her, summons her in her, you know, governance, when that throne was also brought, you know, she accepts that I bring, you know, iman upon the God of Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salam, and she mentions that although we were Muslims as well before, you know, before we believed, you know, the Queen of Sheba, they were believers. You know, as it says that inna deena indallahi Islam, near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the deen is Islam. It is, Islam is not only the deen, for example, that started in 1620 AD. No, it has been there since the time of Adam alayhi salam. So this lady, this queen, was someone who was a believer, someone who had iman, and she said that, yes, we believed it, but now my belief goes on a different level, which is believing in the way that how Hazrat Sulaiman believes. You know, that is Islam after Islam again, right? So there's Islam, and then Islam after Islam. Then you have the third level, which is a deeper level, and that is, you know, we recite in Surah Hadith, where we say, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, you know, as it says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ittaqullah, wa aminu bi rasulihi yutikum kiflaini min rahmati. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, those who have brought iman, ittaqullah, be God conscious, be God wary, you know, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be pious. This is after bringing iman. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ittaqullah. They have iman, then they have taqwa, and then what the Quran says? The Quran says, wa aminu bi rasulihi. And then again it says, bring iman. So this is the daraja where, or this is the level where it is iman after iman. So it's Islam, Islam after Islam, which is also, as we said, is the body, which is, you know, iman. And then this is much deeper, and that is iman after iman. And this iman after iman is where, for example, some of the mufassirin, some of the exegists have mentioned, like for example in Tafsir Burhan, that this ayah is in reference to Hazrat Salman Farsi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ittaqullah, and then wa aminu bi rasulihi. Perhaps Hazrat Salman Farsi was already a mu'min who have already brought iman, and then the God consciousness, the God wariness, and then wa aminu bi rasulihi, and then he brought iman upon the rasul, and then eventually the result of that was that two mercies, special lights, were provided to him, which we don't want to get into the tafsir of that, because we just want to point out to the level of iman. So it's iman after iman, where a person is far away from any sort of, you know, ill conduct, vague and wrong speech, and in terms of his action is somewhere where a person is قَدْ أَفْلَهَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, you know, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي سَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Surah Mu'minun is the best to really look at what sort of person a mu'min is, where he is in salat khashi, you know, God fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he is far away from all sort of anlaghwihi muridun, you know, he's far away from all sort of love and unnecessary speech and talk, right? So this is once again iman after iman. The third daraja is, which is considered as a special Islam, and that is particularly to the Prophet, where the Prophet, they themselves, for example, Hazrat Ibrahim, Rabbana waj'alna muslimain lak. You know, he's doing dua. Is he not Muslim? Then why is he doing dua? That you make us Muslim and our zurriyat, for example, for the future. It makes sense if he's saying my future generation as Muslims, but Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam is saying that, you know, you make us as well. You know, someone who is from the Muslim, you know, from the Muslims. مَا كَانَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ يَهُودِيًا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًا وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا. Hazrat Ibrahim is not Yahud, is not Nasara, but he is Hanif and he is a Muslim. So this is another type of Islam, or the heart of that Islam is Iman, is of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. Then after that level is on a higher level, which is Khasul Khas, as they say, the fourth level. And that is where Hazrat Rasul Akram Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that he is considered to be that someone who is Awwala Muslim. You know, he is the first. Well, first Muslim, if we are going with that terminology, with that definition that everything is Islam, Inna Dina Inna Allahi Islam, and Hazrat Adam should be the first Muslim. But the verse is saying that Rasul, the Prophet, is saying, I am the first Muslim. He's saying, I am the first Muslim. If all prophets were Muslim, like for example the previous ayah which we recited, Hazrat Ibrahim is not Yahud nor Nasara, but he is a Muslim. But Hazrat, the ayah is saying here, is that where Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, Rasulullah Khuda sallallahu alayhi salam says that, he says, wa ana awwalu muslimi. You know, I am the first amongst the Muslimin. I am the first Muslim. Now, what type of Muslim? A Muslim who have completely surrendered with his heart, with everything, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing of his. He is abd. He is a perfect slave of God. That is the highest level. You know, of what? Of Iman, once again. Now, with all these different levels of Iman that exist, this Iman, this reality, this phenomena comes to aid of ours. Where that be, that Iman where Hazrat Jibrail comes, that your grandson will be slaughtered that way, Rasul says that, so what? If Islam is saved, you know, fabiha, you know, I would accept, isn't it? So that is also surrendering, that even if the grandson be slaughtered that way, no grandfather wants that, no mother wants, you know, the kids to be killed in that fashion. But they have reached that level of Iman that for that sake, for Islam, you know, let be so. Whatever been given, let it be fana, let it be annihilated in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Hussein alayhi salam gave everything what was given to him in terms of his wujud. He sacrificed everything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave everything. Now, as he has given everything, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in return gives everything. This argument is usually used by some of those who try to compare the salat with azadari. You know, they say that, you know, so what if we don't do salat, we are doing majlis of Imam Hussein alayhi salam? Because Imam Hussein, you know, that story where there was this old lady, and this old lady, you know, when like, the king comes, cooks some food and gives that sheep or whatever she had. Whatever she had, she gave to that king to save the life of that king. The king goes back, she comes to the, you know, kingdom, and then she asks in return, you know, of the favor. Some say, okay, you know, give her some bags of money or whatever. The other says, give half of the kingdom. But one Hakim says that no, she gave everything she had. The king have to give everything the king have. So Imam Hussein gave everything what he had to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give everything what he must give everything what he have according to the rule. So therefore, whether a person prays or doesn't pray, he's loving Imam Hussein alayhi salam, you know, he will be taken care of. But Imam Hussein alayhi salam is not the one who is saying that what I have I'm giving you. Imam Hussein is saying, I am faqir. Nothing is of me that I'm giving you. The beauty is that, where Imam Hussein says his wujud is not his wujud, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah who have given him that. So when I am returning that, you know, is it really a favor that I am doing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That is the ultimate, you know, level of annihilation, of fana in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then this will not make those people who try to argue, for example, for the sake of that, Imam Hussein, he will do shafaat, for instance, or it is all right. No, Imam Hussain says, it's nothing of me. Everything belongs to him. And those who were of that iman, that's how they sacrifice. Whether they be little ones, whether they be, you know, young and supporters and companions of Imam Hussain. As we said, that when Imam Hussain on the day of Ashura, he was in the midst of battle, fighting the enemies. After all were shaheed, he would come to the tents and he would recite, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. This is in order to show that Hussein is still alive. O Zainab, do not have that anxiety. Do not worry that I am still here. And in one of the returns, or in one of the time where he returns to the tents, he recited once again, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And here Zainab lifts the curtain. The Rawi reports that as soon as this curtain was lifted, Imam Hussain alayhi salam saw the young lad who was about 11 or 10 years old, who was known to be the son of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. And then as he was looking at him and he advised Hazrat Zainab, take care of Abdullah. And then he returned back to fight. He was ambushed. And as he engages himself in this battle, that hour happens where Abdullah moves while looking at his uncle, surrounded by the enemies. And as he moves forward and he asks, O people, what are you trying to do? You are trying to kill my uncle. And as he moved, there was an enemy who wanted to strike with his sword, Imam Hussain alayhi salam. He raises his arms in order to stop that. The hand was chopped from the elbow. And as the hand was chopped from the elbow, Imam Hussain alayhi salam quickly grabs Abdullah and he hugs Abdullah. And Hurmula, when he takes that arrow out and targets Hazrat Abdullah and he shoots that arrow. When he shoots that arrow, it pierces Hazrat Abdullah and it hits the chest of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And this little lad, he flutters, he trembles in blood in the arms of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And Imam Hussain alayhi salam says to his nephew, O Abdullah, be patient. This is how we will meet. An arrow that have pierced Abdullah and that also have pierced Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam with one arrow. The blood mixes and he says, we will be raised on the day of judgment and we will say to Imam Hassan alayhi salam, to my brother, that we have sacrificed together for the sake of Deen Mustafa. And this was the sacrifice of Abdullah. Let me remind you of those who came, the little ones. I will give you or recite you of the tradition of not the day of Ashura, but his masaib will be recited tomorrow. The 6-month-old babe of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. I will recite you from the scholar Allama Askari Marhum, where he recites this riwayat, where on the 28th of Rajab, when the caravan was about to leave to Karbala, the Imam Hussain alayhi salam had a daughter whose name was Fatima as well. Everybody parted farewell. Fatima is not going with Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And when Fatima is parting farewell to Ali Asghar, Ali Asghar is not leaving the lap of Fatima Sughra. And the caravan is ready to move. But as Asghar is not in the caravan is not moving. Imam Hussain inquires that what's happening. Then they say that Asghar is in the lap of Fatima Sughra and doesn't want to leave. And here Imam Hussain alayhi salam goes to Fatima Sughra and he kisses Hazrat Ali Asghar alayhi salam and he whispers something in the ear of Ali Asghar. And Ali Asghar throws himself the same way how he throwed himself from the cradle when Imam Hussain alayhi salam, they did that call, that is there anyone to help me? In the same fashion, Ali Asghar throws himself out from the lap of Fatima Sughra. Then they asked, "Oh Hussein, what did you whisper in the ear of Asghar?" Imam Hussein alayhi salam says that Asghar, the message of Karbala is incomplete. Karbala needs your blood. Karbala needs your martyrdom and your shahadat. And as soon as Imam Hussein says that, Ali Asghar alayhi salam throws himself, as he is known as Babul Hawaij, as the poet says, that kasik shishmah babul hawaij beshavat. Tasavvur kunid ki agar be sin-e Abul Fazl mirasat chi mikunat. A soul that becomes babul hawaij in 6 months, imagine what this soul will do when it reaches the age of Abul Fazl Abbas. So Ali Asghar alayhi salam is babul hawaij of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, of all of ours. That the hajat of Hussein is Asghar. Hussein is not leaving Medina unless Asghar is there. He goes to Fatima Sughra and he whispers this, "Hussein needs you, Asghar." And Asghar throws himself in the lap of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Allah la'natullah ala qawm al-zalimin sayalamun ladina zalimu ayyamun qalibin yanqalibun. Tonight is the night of hajat. Tonight is the night of Eve. Shabe Juma, night of acceptance of dua. On this night we give the interest, we intercede the Babul Hawaij of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. We intercede Abdullah ibn Hassan, the children who sacrificed their life, the children of both Imams, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussain, to come to our aid and assistance in this dunya and in the hereafter, and to come to the aid of our marhumeen. بفاطمة وأبيها وبالها وبنيها وسر المستودع فيها بعدد ما أحاط به علمك بمولانا باب الحوائج علي أصغر عليه السلام يا الله 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 يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي على دينك يا قاضي الحاجات يا كافي المهمات إنك على كل شيء قدير رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة لأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات especially the marhumin of the brothers and sisters who are present here with the loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.